Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 8th meeting in 2017 of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee. I would remind those present, please, to turn off their mobile telephones. Everyone is present, so no apologies have been received. I'd like to move to agenda item one on our agenda, which is to do with major transport infrastructure projects. I'd like to welcome Keith Brown, the Cabinet Secretary for Economy, Jobs and Fair Work. And we received an update from you, Mr. Brown, on the 14th of December regarding various projects. The Minister is joined by Michelle Rennie, the Director of Major Transport and Infrastructure Projects, and Graham Porteous, the Head of Special Projects at Transport Scotland. Minister, you asked to attend the meeting, and therefore we would welcome an opening statement from you.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thanks to the Committee for the chance to provide an update. I think at the last discussion that we had, the committee made it clear they would like to be kept updated as frequently as possible, any emerging issues being cited for the committee so they could take recognizance of that, and that's the reason why I've asked to come back to the committee. I think in particular both the Forth Crossing, which I know you'll hear about subsequently, and the AWPR, but I'll mention where we're at with most of the transport projects that we have. It has been a busy time for the projects. There have been significant works being undertaken across all of the projects over recent months. If I can start perhaps with the AWPR, just to say that since we last had a discussion, which if you recall was around the Balmerie-Tipperty part of the project, further progress has been made. So it's a 58-kilometre site. The progress has been during 2016 and early 2017 as follows. I'd advised previously in committee that phase one of the project at the Aberdeen Airport site had opened in August last year. That was ahead of schedule and is being used and providing benefit to local people. That was ahead of the contractor's planned autumn target and is already bringing those benefits. However, also in November last year, the contractor ARL advised us that was unable to complete the Balmerie to Tipperty section by spring this year as originally planned, due to seasonally affected works, and I alerted the committee to this change in December, and would just like to provide a brief update on the progress that the contractor has made since then. So the Stonehaven southbound slip roads are expected to open in spring this year, bringing again early benefits to the people of Stonehaven by taking long distance traffic away from the town. At the major bridge over the River Dee, the south pier is now complete and the north pier is in progress, and once completed the works to install the bridge deck will commence. Those works, which will include the slip forming of the concrete deck using a balanced cantilever approach, are due to begin by late spring. Road surfacing works recommenced last week in the southern section, and the road foundation works are due to recommence this week. The fast approaching spring season will also see the recommencement of the remaining earthwork operations. There was some discussion, I think, last night in the media about utilities, and it's worth mentioning that I think there was some press activity. This project was unusual in as far as we were well aware of some of the pressure on utilities, so I'd asked for all the utility providers to come in advance of the contract being let to a meeting so we could discuss the ability to make sure that those utilities were undertaken, the diversions where they were necessary were undertaken as smoothly as possible. That was an exceptional thing. We've done that on no other project. It's also true to say, and of course there'll be elements of the commercial discussions with the contractor which I can't divulge, but it's also true to say that at the contractor's request we've helped out in addition to that with one in particular substantial utility diversion, which again I won't go into the details, but again at the request of the contractor I wrote to the utility, not a public utility provider, to help out with that. So utilities will always be a major feature of contracts such as this. As notified to the committee, the delay in relation to completing the Balmerie to Tipperty section was announced at that time, but overall, despite the revised programme for Balmerie to Tipperty, our advisers have independently confirmed that the overall programme of delivery for the works by the winter 17-18 period remains achievable. Of course, there are challenges with that, as there are with all successful major projects. It does require sound project management and, of course, sufficient resourcing by the contractor, in addition to a willingness to resolve any issues between the parties in a sensible way, and we undertake those discussions as we do in all major contracts. Sometimes, of course, those can result in tensions, but both the contractors and ourselves are trying to do everything that we can to make sure that we complete this overall project on time. I think I did mention last time, because the issue had been had arisen, whether in relation to Balmerie Tipperty or any other delays, whether there was a penalty paid to the contractor. Just worth repeating the fact that that's not how it works. It just means they do not receive any monies. So they will be receiving monies just now for the airport section, which I mentioned earlier on, because it's actually in use. So the penalty is essentially that the contractors don't receive funding for that. But we are, just to conclude on AWPR, the Transport Scotland and I continue to work together with ARL to deliver the benefits of the project as soon as possible. I think the next project I would want to mention would be the Queen's Ferry Crossing, although I won't anticipate too much of what you'll hear from those involved in that. The final deck closure, I'm sure you'll have seen, was completed on the 3rd of February. You'll hear more evidence later about the progress. I'd like to take the opportunity, though, to provide the committee with some detail on that and other major transport projects. You will have seen, as I say, the completion of the deck. So what's now being undertaken are things like the waterproofing of the deck surface, the surfacing of the deck as well to take traffic, and of course the wind barriers. But as I say, you'll hear more about that afterwards, convener, so just move on to other projects if that's okay. The A9 dualling design work well underway on the 11 road schemes that make up the 80 miles of the programme, one of the biggest transport infrastructure projects in Scotland's history. You might have been aware that some of the residents of the villages of Kindalach and Guy and Diwali have had concerns about some of the proposed options for dualling on the grounds, that it will have negative impacts on the villages and their properties. The preferred route for that section was made public in December, with the online option being chosen. But it's true to say that residents remain concerned and made representations, in fact, to the Pitlochry Cabinet meeting, which took place on the 6th of February, the public meeting afterwards. So I spoke to residents, members of Transport Scotland senior management team, subsequently spoke to some of them by telephone on the 7th of February to address some of those concerns. And residents of Burnham and Dunkeld remain in discussion with Transport Scotland around what's called a co-creative process to capture community input into the route options design and assessment. So we envisage this commencing after the local government elections in May, allowing further progress towards identifying a preferred option. And on the 31st of January, the Academy 9 programme launched a Scottish Credit and Qualifications Framework module that will assist teachers involved in STEM subjects to help raise awareness about the A9 dualling programme in the areas of engineering, ecology, geology and sustainability. And their blog went live recently as well, Academy 9 Glow blog. It also features extensive material on the A9 programme for use by teachers and pupils, and we look forward to supporting its use in schools across the length of the A9 in the coming years. On specifically the concreted already section of the A9 dualling, traffic's already using the southbound carriageway. Some of you may be familiar with that. And we remain on schedule to fully open the 7.5-kilometre stretch of this summer, improving the safety of the route and providing better access to and from the Highlands. Also on the A9, a prior information notice or PIN notice for the construction contract for the 9.5-kilometre section between Lunkerty to Burnham has now been published, and we hope to hold an industry day in the coming weeks to discuss the scheme with potential bidders. And preparatory works to facilitate that construction will begin later this year, with the main works contract scheduled to commence in early 2018. Design work continues apace across the rest of the route between Perth and Inverness, with a series of exhibitions currently underway. And that also allows local communities to view the preferred routes for the 24-kilometre lengthy section between Dalrady and Slocht, and the 16-kilometre Crubenmore to Kincraig schemes. And that's a further 40 kilometres of the A9 dualling programme. And lastly, on the A9, work is also underway to identify contractors to carry out a series of advanced works across the entire A9 route in preparation for future construction. The opportunities are expected to be of particular interest to small and medium-sized businesses, including those based locally who'd like to be part of the innovative and ambitious programme. The other big programme we have, of course, is the A96 dualling and a contract notice for design work. I think the estimated prices for those, although they can only be estimates at this early stage of both projects, given that many contracts are still to be let, was similar at around £3 billion. And a contract notice for the design work on the 26-mile stretch of the A96 from east of Huntly to Aberdeen, also known as the Eastern Section, was published on the 24th of January. That major contract marks a further milestone towards the dualling of the A96 with all the investment and improvements that will bring to the North East and the Highlands. And the timescale we had mentioned for that was a 2030 with the A9 by 2025. Transport Scotland has also completed the development and assessment of the preferred option for the 31-kilometre A96 dualling Inverness to Nairn, including the Nairn bypass section, and have published draft orders for the scheme on the 29th of November for formal comment, and the objection period ran for 9 weeks and ended on the 31st of January. Effective engagement with affected parties is a key part of the statutory process, and it's been my experience that the more discussion that you can have in these earlier stages of the process, then the smoother the rest of the process can become, and they can also enjoy the support of affected parties in many cases. But as with all projects of that nature, we will engage directly with the objectors to try and resolve objections, and I've spoken to some local members of the Scottish Parliament who have issues that they've wanted to raise already in relation to the project. But it's only when the objectors have come forward that we'll be able to see whether a public local inquiry will be required to consider objections which have been received but not withdrawn. And ultimately, ministers will consider the outcome of all the consultations and objections raised, including the objections, sorry, the recommendations made by independent reporters, if that happens. The objections received that we've received so far are currently being assessed. However, in the event that we can't resolve all of these, then the public local inquiry will happen. We'd expect that to happen late this year or early next year. On the M8, M73, M74 motorway improvements project, the focus of construction has shifted now to completing the various structures across the project. We opened the Wraith underpass to traffic on the 16th of February. The project is a 560-metre long underpass. I don't know if the committee's had the chance to have a look at it. It's a very impressive development. It provides a direct link from the A725 Belsill bypass to the A725. East Kilbride Expressway. We've had substantial feedback from local people about the benefits that that's brought for them. It also received positive media coverage and is delivering benefits to users of the A7725. The full benefits, though, of the interchange will not be obtained until the works on the M74 are complete, and we've now reached the stage of construction where it's necessary to connect the new offline infrastructure, which is now almost complete with the existing online road network. And there's a very significant height difference, which is why we've had to put in place a 10-week diversion, which has added, on average, or was projected to add, around 10 minutes delay. Unavoidable at this stage of the project, but we're now, I think, 2, possibly 3 weeks into that 10-week period. And although there have been delays, it has been effective. The diversion route allows a tie-in of the new M8 motorway and it will be in place, as I say, for approximately 10 weeks, and traffic on the surrounding roads has been heavier. The diversion itself is performing well, and officials continue to work closely with SRP to ensure that traffic management is removed at the earliest opportunity that it's safe to do so. We had interest from members of the committee, including Mike Rumbles, at the last meeting on the Lawrencekirk bypass, although it's been taken forward by my colleague Hamza Youssef, and I think the committee will have received an update after our last discussion. But I'll just say one or two words about that. So we had announced a £24 million package for the design and construction of a new grade separated junction at Lawrencekirk. And that was part of a package of additional investment alongside the Aberdeen City Region deal. So Transport Scotland appointed design consultants for the scheme in September and is taking forward the next stage of design development for the junction improvement, which is the options assessment, and thereafter will proceed through the relevant statutory procedures. The ongoing essential design and assessment process to identify the preferred junction layout is programmed to be complete in 2018. Development and detailed assessment of the preferred option will follow this, culminating in a publication of the draft orders in 2019 for formal comment. Obviously, still a lot of development work to be carried out, but we'll continue to push forward the preparation stages to deliver that scheme as soon as possible, and that will bring improved road safety and economic benefits to road users and the local community in the wider North East. And with that, convener, I'll conclude my remarks and thank the committee again for the opportunity to provide the update, and happy to try and take any questions along with my colleagues on any of these issues.
Okay, thank you very much. First question, Peter.
Thank you, and thank you for that update, Minister. Just for the avoidance of any doubt, it says in our papers here that the AWPR scheme is to be finished by the winter of 2018. Now, you could read that two ways. That could be the winter of 2017-2018, or it could also be the winter of 2018-2019. Just for the avoidance of any doubt, when is the figure that you are going to complete this work?
The winter we're referring to, and it will go into the spring of 2017-18. We said the spring of 2018, initially when the contract, I think the former First Minister announced that at the start. So it's the winter that we're about to face, not the one we're coming out of and not the one after that, but it's 2017-18, that winter.
Yeah, right, thank you. We also would like to know, are we on target, are we on budget as well? I mean, are we on target to meet that timescale, but are we on budget as well? I mean, you know, anecdotal evidence suggests that this project is running well over budget. Can you give us any clarity on that?
Yes, I think I can. I think I mentioned already in my opening statement that we have independently had it assessed that this project can be achieved on time, so that's what we intend. In terms of the budget, again, just to, maybe Michelle can come in on what we've actually spent so far, but the way that it's paid for is obviously over a period of time through a unitary charge, and that does not kick in until we actually have possession of the roads. So some expenditure will have been incurred already on the road, which is already opened, but the bulk of the expenditure won't begin until we actually have the roads opened. So no, there's not an increase in the budget. We haven't started to pay that yet, but I don't know if Michelle wants to say more on that as well.
I don't have the figures of what we've spent to date, but what I can tell you is that we are still within the total scheme cost of £745 million at this point.
Okay, I mean, I'm pleased to hear that. There are one or two other issues I need to bring up. I mean, I'm getting complaints on almost a daily basis from farmers along the route, and compensation claims that they are putting in, you know, for damage done to their property. It seems to be an absolute minefield getting to the bottom of that. I mean, this issue was brought up with Humza when he came up to meet with the folks in the northeast, but it hasn't gone away. No farmer expects to make money out of this scheme, but equally no farmer should be left out of pocket because of this scheme, and that's exactly what's going on just now. Claims, you know, absolutely relevant claims, are being kicked into long grass. It seems to be taking forever and a day to come to a conclusion. And in the meantime, there's serious amounts of money outlined and farmers. And the sad thing about this is that there was a real sense of goodwill between the farming community and the contractors at one time. That has completely and utterly disappeared. They don't want to work along with them.
Can I ask you to come to a specific question? And before you wrap up with that specific question, could you also just make, I'm sure the Minister, the Cabinet Secretary is well aware that you are a farmer, but you might care to want to make a declaration of your own.
Sorry, I need to make that declaration because I am speaking about farmers and I apologise for that. But the question is, there's two questions. One, the fencing is completely inadequate. I know about fencing. I've been fencing all my life. Sheep will not be held in by the fences that are being provided along this road. I can assure you that. It'll hold in cattle, it won't hold in sheep. And we need to get these claims sorted out a lot quicker than we are doing.
Okay, thanks for that. And I know there are issues. I've been up to talk to some landowners specifically about this issue in the past, and it's probably right that it comes to me, not to Humza, to be fair. All I can say is that there is a process which has to, it's been set down for many years, and it's got built in an independence to the process and a proper legal, whether it's a district valuer or the Land Tribunal, it's got proper procedures laid in place. It's not the intention to delay it unnecessarily, and I have made the point, just as you have, that people should not be left out of pocket on this. That should be the basic principle that applies here. And sometimes when there is a delay for perfectly understandable reasons from either party, then if we can do something to help with that, we will do that. But the only way I can respond really is if the individual cases that you have, and I think I've probably seen some of them, if you want to refer them to me in Transport Scotland, if there's something we can do that doesn't undermine the process which has to be gone through and it's an independent legal process, then we'll undertake that on a case-by-case basis. I'll make that offer if you want to get in touch about that.
Okay. Mike, you're next.
And just before I ask my question on the AWPR, can I just welcome your final comment, which is not the least comment, of course, which is the Lawrence Kirk Junction as well. I certainly do appreciate that. I know the members of the committee and Laurie will certainly welcome that as well. So that was really good news. Focusing on the Aberdeen Western Peripheral route then, to follow really what Peter's saying, I mean, here we are in the spring, in March 2017. So what you're basically saying is we should expect by March 2018 the project to be complete. Can I just confirm that? Because there's always a little bit of not quite sure what we're meaning by the seasons.
Well, I agree with your year, not necessarily the month. A season's a bit more elastic than that particular month, but I confirm, as I said to Peter Chapman before, that's the period we're talking about, spring next year. So over the winter, the course of the winter, by the end of the winter next year, that's where we intend to finish.
Yeah. That's great. I mean, I just compare it to your forecast for the bridge, because we've got a specific month and people, you know, the lay people out there. I get questions, what month are we looking forward to? So but approximately March next year.
Approximately. It could be a month either side of that. That I would accept that. Even May sometimes is referred to spring in some places. But, but we're not looking to, I'm not looking to align. It's possible it could be earlier than that, and it's possible it could be later than March. But we intend that it will be finished.
But this time next year we should be happy.
I think so, yes. And that's our intention. It's also the intention of the contractor. But can I just come back to the point about the fourth crossing? Because I know what you mentioned in relation to that. The December date that was mentioned, as you will know, was mentioned not as the contract date. It was never the contract completion date, but we hope to have that finished when in 2005 we'd been told that the cables of the bridge would mean that we'd have to stop HGVs from travelling on the bridge by 2017. That's why we said the end of 2016. As it turned out, from the work that was done on the cables, that wasn't necessary, and we still anticipate we'll finish that project by its contract completion date, if not earlier.
Thank you. Just before we move on, Stuart's got a question. We were joined briefly here by a delegation from the Roads and Transport Committee of the Senate of the Parliament of Kenya, and we'd like to welcome you to our committee, and I know we're going to have some discussions later, but welcome to the committee. Stuart, if you'd like to ask your question.
Vina, I just wanted to focus on Balmedy Tipperty. The reason that we were given previously for the reschedule was essentially weather. And I just wanted to test whether the works which will be being undertaken in the plan in the forthcoming winter are as weather dependent as the works that were previously delayed by the winter that's passed, or whether we're then at the stage where there will not be zero potential impact, but there's a substantially reduced impact of weather on that project.
That's right. I mean, it's probably unfair to blame the weather. It's more true to say that they didn't get as far advanced with the works before the winter came in, and it was the earthworks specifically that was the problem, and that will certainly have been completed before the next winter. But I don't know if I'm getting that right, if I can ask Michelle.
That's correct, Cabinet Secretary. But it wouldn't be correct to say that in undertaking a 58-kilometre job in the outdoors in the northeast of Scotland that weather will have no impact. And it's about it being the right kind of weather for the activity that is underway at the time. So, for instance, heavy rain is detrimental to earthwork activities. So, therefore, undertaking earthworks activities in the winter is a very risky operation. In terms of productivity. But equally, if you're laying road surfacing, very low temperatures can be problematic there. So there is no particular risk with regard to weather at this point in time, but we will be working outside and, you know, we are always susceptible to the weather.
Well, perhaps just to close it off and allow others to ask other questions, what sort of activities are likely to be being undertaken in that more adverse weather period that we occasionally call winter?
Well, just now you will have the, as I mentioned in the opening statement, you have the recommencement of the earthworks, and then beyond that you'll be using to the preparation of the surface and the surfacing of the road itself.
Yeah, and we'll also be completing the structures over that period.
That's in 17-18 winter.
That's right, yeah.
So there is still weather risk, but we're beyond the major impacts that stop all the work when you can't do the earthworks.
I think if I can just add that, from my view, and obviously I receive advice from Transport Scotland to talk directly to the contractor, I would be very firm about saying you cannot say that you didn't get quite as far before the winter of this year, which meant that it had to go substantially into next year, but you were quite close to it, and that you can have the same excuse next year. That would not be acceptable for me. So I don't anticipate that happening, but that would not be acceptable to do that.
Thank you.
Sorry, can I, Cabinet Secretary, can I just ask you, because after your last appearance, and Redwood's wanted to come in on another question, but after your last appearance, I looked at this issue of earthworks and the difficulties of doing earthworks in the winter. Made me smile that earthworks have continued up the A9 apace and seem to have progressed on. In fact, they've been going on every week that I've been going up and down the road. So it seems not to be an issue on the A9, but seems to be an issue on the Aberdeen Road. Would you care to comment on that?
That's absolutely what the contractor has said to us, but perhaps Michelle's got a bit more experience in constructing roads than I have.
We can't make a general statement about earthworks full stop. Obviously, some earthworks happen during the winter period. The issue for AWPR was very specific about the geographical location and the number of watercourses in that area and the impact on those watercourses and the impact the previous winter and spring on those watercourses. And it was agreed between the contractor and the various environmental bodies that they would cease earthworks operation during the winter period to mitigate the effect on those watercourses so that we could avoid any incidents like we had previous to that.
It's also true to say on the A9, if you've been travelling up there, you'll see the one bit, certainly the last time I was there recently, the one bit that was still standing out was right next to the river, the burn that runs through, and the bridge had to go across it. So that would suggest that that's the common factor.
Yes, I mean, watercourses are important, and I mean, the Spey and the Spey catchment is obviously affected in the same way that other rivers are. I just wondered if there was a correlation. Sorry, Reda wanted to ask a question.
Can I go back and ask about utilities you mentioned in your opening statement? You say that you got the utility companies, both public and private, together ahead of the contract to try and iron out problems. Is that a ministerial responsibility, Transport Scotland, or indeed the contractor's responsibility?
It's a shared responsibility. Transport Scotland has a role in relation to that, and I suppose they exercise their powers, obviously, on behalf of ministers. And obviously we have, if it's, say, Scottish Water, we have a different relationship there because it's a public utility. But it's a shared responsibility. The point in doing that is that given where we're going with the AWPR and especially in the urban areas or being close to urban areas, we knew that utilities diversions, actually we knew that from the trams project was what was the most obvious. And if you think about the timing of when we were looking at AWPR, we were right in the teeth of that issue with the trams projects where people essentially were digging up roads in Edinburgh, not knowing what was underneath the surface. So for that reason, we took a very different approach and asked them to come in, a precautionary approach. As to the different responsibilities, I think that's my understanding, but I don't know if you want to add to it, Michelle.
I think that's correct. The Transport Scotland undertake, as you can imagine, there are complex interfaces between utilities and all of these infrastructure projects, actually. And work has to occur over a period of years in preparing these projects and in agreeing the likely diversions that will need to take place. And those often require some years in the planning, actually, with utility companies. So all of that work happens well before we ever award a contract. At the point of award, the responsibility for managing those utilities falls to the contractor, because it's important that he is able to liaise direct with those utility companies and make sure that their programmes tie in with his own programme for completing the works.
Okay. You also alluded in your opening statement that there was an issue with one of the private utilities. That then appears quite complex to sort out, because if it was Transport Scotland that was doing the groundwork, for want of a better phrase, with them, and then an issue has occurred when the contractor has taken it over. If that adds costs to the project, who is responsible for those additional costs?
The contractor, but I'm not sure I would agree with the role of Transport Scotland in relation to that. And again, I would have to caution, I'm not able to be completely free with all the facts in it, because it's a commercial relationship here, but I'll give my understanding, hopefully not go too far on that, and Michelle can correct me. The particular private utility that was involved, I think the contractor had some issues with trying to achieve the diversion that was sought. and they came to me and asked me specifically on this one utility if I would try and intervene on their behalf, which we're not obliged to do, as Michelle has said, but we did do that to try and effect that. But my understanding, if there's additional costs that arise from elements to do with diversions, then it would fall to the contractor, but I'm happy to be corrected.
Yeah, the issue here wasn't a cost one, it was a timing one, and it was about me ensuring that the utilities were adequately resourced in order to meet the programme that the contractor had set out. And on that occasion, the contractor was given a little bit of additional support from us and from ministers to be able to assist with his discussions with that utility company.
Support or
no
backup?
No.
Okay. So if it adds to a financial cost, who would bear that? Or are you not at liberty to say at this moment? And if not, when will we get that information?
There's no suggestion at this time that those diversionary works will generate additional cost.
Okay, but if they cause a delay, one imagines the cost then falls to the contractor because they're not getting their payment for that part of the route. It's not online. They would expect a payment then. If they feel that that is not their problem, that they had done everything they could to mitigate that, do they have recourse to the Scottish Government for additional funding for that?
I mean, I think the short answer is no, they don't. The contract that's signed does undertake to pay the unitary charge fee at that time, and it's up to the contractor to manage the risks during the course of the construction of the contract. Of course, in different contracts, you'll see if they do think there's something which has been out with their control, they can raise those issues through different dispute or legal processes, but that's not the case in this particular case. But it's their responsibility to manage the risks, and the risk is, as you've just said, if they don't complete. Crucially, it comes down to when the road is available. And we will only start paying for that when the road is available, and it's up to them to manage those risks. It's not quite as clear-cut as I was saying, just get on with it and get it done, it's all your problem, as the example you've mentioned highlights. We have that discussion with them, we will try and help out. And in the earlier example they gave of actually being proactive and getting all the utility companies together and saying, you know, how we wanted to have this road done. The delay had been a long delay before this road was started through legal processes. So we do get involved in that, but it is the contractor's risk to manage. Would that be right to say?
Yeah, I mean, the biggest risk for the contractor is time, because time costs him money. So whatever he can do to mitigate the time effect on his programme is important to him. And that's where the support that he got from ministers comes into play. So what's critical for him is that the utility diversions happen when they need to happen in order to allow him to proceed with his work, and so that they're not holding him up in any way.
Mm-hmm. Can I just follow that up? Because we're just to understand this, is that what you're saying is there were discussions with the utilities and there have been issues, but they're all resolved and they're not going to stop the project completing on time.
I wouldn't say they're all resolved. They'll still have the contract will still have to talk to all the different utilities. Many of the diversions have taken place, but there'll be further diversions still to take place through the contract. So that they have to manage that process.
Sorry, Cabinet Secretary, just to tie you down completely on that, are you anticipating or are you aware that any of the diversions required for the utilities are going to delay the project in any shape or form?
Well, I think I've said now two, maybe three times that we expect this contract to be completed on time. Now, I don't take a wee look at it myself and make a judgment. That comes from our independent assessors of that process, and they're saying this can be achieved on time. But there will be further risks to manage. We're, you know, still in perhaps the most crucial phase of the project. If you look at the fourth crossing, and to some extent the M8 bundle as well, although it seems to be through that part of the process now coming towards the very end, this is a crucial part of the programme. But it's up to the contractor to manage those risks, and we will help out to do that in order to try and complete this on time, and we currently expect that to be completed on time.
Okay, sorry, Reddy, did you have a further question on that? And then Stuart's got one.
And just a very short question. Given that it's in phases, do you expect any phase to be delayed, albeit that, you know, the overall contract should be completed on time? Do you expect a delay in certain phases of it?
Well, the phase which you mentioned is Balmady Tipperty. That's obviously been delayed, and we've also mentioned that we brought ahead the airport junction one. There's not any particular phases which are still to be, we expect a change to, it could change over time, but we're not expecting any changes to phases, would that be right?
That's correct.
As a matter of public policy, way leave is granted to utility providers, which facilitates their being able to put their utility connections over land and water, for that matter. Is it a matter of public policy that the implicit deal is that in exchange for having that benefit to the utility companies, they have to play ball with public projects thereafter? And would it be an opportunity, perhaps, for the record, for the longer term? I think Wayleave's been around for over 100 years, so it's not new, that there is that implicit deal, and utility companies should take very close care to support public projects when they themselves are in receipt of a public benefit.
I think Wayleaves, we could get into a big discussion on Wayleaves. We could actually get into the situation where what you class as public benefit, whether it's housing and whether they should be moved. Oh. I think maybe, Stuart, I mean, unless you want a very quick answer on that, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as to implicit agreements, perhaps I'm better to let Michelle answer that.
Utility companies have a number of obligations arising from things like New Roads and Street Works Act and other statutory obligations, and with that they have a duty actually to engage. The difficulty always arises where one party is reliant on a third party performance in order for them to perform their own duties, and that will continue to be the case.
Thank you. Unless there's any other questions on that, I think we'd like to move on. There's some questions on Prestwick Airport, and John's going to start off on that.
I mean, I think most of us are very positive about Prestwick Airport. We want it to succeed. There's jobs there. It carries a lot of freight. It's got potential, size of the runway, all that kind of thing. However, it did, as we understand, make a loss of £8.7 million in 2015-16, and that is covered by a loan. So if it continues to make losses, I mean, how long will the government keep lending? And is there a limit to how much loans would be given to the airport?
Well, we've made clear what we would do in terms of loans at the time that we, or shortly after, we purchased the airport through the business plan that was produced. And I think it's probably fair to say, well, we also said that our intention is to see the airport return to profitability and also then return it to the market, because we didn't necessarily look to add to our portfolio of airports, but because of the, as you've said, the economic and social implications for jobs in Ayrshire, if you weren't to have done that, were very substantial. And of course, you have to balance those costs with what we've had to put into the airport. What I would say is, and again, I can't speak to every part of what Prestwick is currently doing in terms of trying to turn around its current situation, because it's commercially confidential. I think if we were not satisfied at the airport, we're trying very hard and had evidence for that. So, for example, the recent investment from, there was two, one was, I think, Chevron, they were called, a company from the north of England who have taken out hangar space there. And also some of the surrounding businesses at Prestwick, adding to a real aviation hub, which I think help us have some confidence to the ability of Prestwick, along with other airports, to bid to become a spaceport. If we weren't happy with what they were doing, I think we'd, as we do, want to be asking serious questions about it. We don't just hand over this money and think that's it and there's a never-ending pot. And Prestwick Airport management are well aware of that fact. There's a huge amount of work going on. I've been talking to them just in the last two or three weeks about specific commercial opportunities. I think it's true to say as well there are real difficulties in terms of passenger traffic. They had that before it was bought, and it's proven very difficult because of other events since then to boost that. They still, of course, have Ryanair, but they have had substantial success in terms of the MRO operations and in terms of freight as well. So we understood, and we always said this was going to be a long process. We don't think there's an open-ended pot of money we should be handing across. We do analyse each time there's a request for especially capital finance and make sure that the public taxpayers' money is being looked after. But we knew this was going to be a long process before it started. And there are a number of irons in the fire in relation to Prestwick, which we hope will bear fruition.
I mean, it seems to me that if it was even to break even, that would be a huge success. And therefore, the chances of them making a profit of 8.7 million to pay back the past loss and loan, you know, does seem a bit remote. I mean, can I ask, has the government, this has got to be a doubtful debt, surely. Has provision been made against this debt, or is it being held at full face value?
We made provision in the budgets going back, I think, 3 years, on a three-year basis for these monies to be handed over. But I think we do still, despite what you say about the difficult nature of this, we do still hold to the original intention that the investment by the taxpayer will be paid back. There's no intention of us writing off this debt at this stage. We intend that it will come back. And we understood, and you know, the record will show in various committees of this Parliament, that we said this was going to be a long-term process. It wasn't going to happen quickly.
Okay, thank you.
Jamie, I think you've got a question. I'm going to bring you in, but Jamie first, if I may.
Thank you. I think John Mason summed up the rationale behind our questioning, but if I could drill down into the numbers somewhat. In this year's budget, there's around 9.4 million of loans in the line for Prestwick Airport. I think anecdotally we're hearing that it will require around 40 million in total before either 21-22, or some suggest perhaps even sooner that number might be reached. I'm intrigued by your terminology in this. You use words like it's a long process, it's a never-ending pot. You know, it won't be a never-ending pot of money, but I think we should be a bit more robust in our analysis of this. You know, how long is a long process? Is this a two-year plan, a five-year plan, a 10-year plan? I can see that the Cabinet Secretary appreciates the efforts of the management to try and turn around the business, but what is the Cabinet Secretary doing to measure the success or not success of that? So are there specific measurable targets that they have to hit on an annual basis to then secure further years' funding? Has the government said, look, guys, you've got three years to turn this around? Or, you know, it seems to me that there's a lot of loose wording, but not a very specific plan for Prestwick Airport.
I think we were very specific initially when we, first of all, bought the airport, and secondly, when we, at our request, had a business plan drawn up, which was submitted to the Parliament's committees, and we were very clear at that time it could well take more than 10 years for this to be turned around. It's not something new. I'm not, you know, making this up. We've said this and been very clear. We've also been very clear that if there's an opportunity to take the airport back to the market beforehand, then the earliest opportunity we would do that. But I think there's been substantial benefit, even in the sums of money which have been used so far, to have saved all the jobs which are there and the impact on the airport. It actually, I think, enjoyed cross-party support at the time. And as to the ongoing scrutiny that the Scottish Government, and I appreciate the Parliament wants to have its own scrutiny quite rightly of this, but we have members from Transport Scotland, our officials, on the Holdco board, which do examine these things on a regular basis. I think if you were to ask the Prestwick management if they felt they were getting sufficient scrutiny from me personally, I think they would say, it's up to them, but I think they would say they would. It's a very robust discussion to have with them on a regular basis. And also, as I say, I can't allude to some of the efforts that they're making because some of them are commercially confidential. You'll know yourself that until a deal is done, you can't make some of these things public. But there is, believe you me, on our part, absolutely a close and robust scrutiny of what they're doing, and you'll have probably seen through the number of parliamentary questions, there's also these questions have to be answered, and I will often use those parliamentary questions to talk to the management of the airport and say, look, these are questions in addition to the ones that I'm asking you have to be aware of. I accept that there's a real public interest in this because there's substantial public money being used. We're not doing it lightly. We examine every request for finance. We undertook at the very start that this would be a long-term process, and I don't think that's changed for us.
I appreciate that answer. Thank you.
John.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Morning.
Cabinet Secretary, you talked about the portfolio, and of course the Scottish Government does own a number of airports, Highlands and Islands Airports Limited. Are you able to explain the rationale why, if you succeed in turning it round, you would go to the market? Why, if something is profitable and it's in public ownership, would you then dispense with it? That makes no sense to me.
Well, because we don't see that it's our role to have that kind of ownership of an airport like that. I think it's quite distinct from the Highlands and Islands airports, which you mentioned, which are not profit-making, which require government support, and we've always accepted that and have provided, certainly during my time as Transport Minister, substantial additional funds to those airports as well to help improve them. But that was never, it was never by design that we got involved in Prestwick Airport. We were faced with a situation of very substantial job losses, not the direct, just the direct ones, but the indirect ones as well. And that's the purpose of our investment. And we made clear at that point, and we're obliged to make clear under European legislation, state aid rules, the basis on which we're going in. You're also obliged to achieve a return on the investment that's been made. So it wasn't a design that we wanted to own this airport in the first place. And we believe that if we can turn this around as we expect that we can do, then it should be returned to the market. That was always our intention. And I know there'll be different views on that, but that was the basis on which we went into this.
I do understand that. Is it your position that state aid rules mean that you're compelled to return to private ownership?
The state aid rules, I think I'd have to check on whether, because of the case that we made at the time for taking over, we're obliged to do that, but we are obliged under state aid rules to make a return on the investment. And it may well be, of course, that is achieved by returning it to the market as well.
But that return could in turn see investment directed to elsewhere in an airport portfolio. This seemed to be out of kilter of the direction of travel of the Scottish Government, which I personally, my party, fully commend in relation to ferries, in relation to the public sector bid for rail, and the interesting announcement over the weekend about bus travel. Surely it's about trying to maximise income for the public purse.
No, I think it's been the standard for governments of different stripes in both Scotland and the UK to act when there's market failure. But if that market failure is corrected and there's a market case for somebody else to come in and make that investment, then it would mean, apart from anything else, we can use that investment instead for the airports that you've referred to. There's only so much money to go around. So if we can use it for the airports that we know we wanted to be involved in the first place, whether it's Stornoway, Shetland, other smaller airports in the Western Isles, if we want to spend our money on those things, we can't also spend it on other airports. So if we can save the jobs which are there, which was the intention, and return it to a place where it can be a viable proposition for a private investor, that's what we said we would do. And I think that's what we should do, because that means that we concentrate on the things that we have to do.
Okay, and just to confirm, all the public money expended and there would be recouped prior to it being returned to private ownership?
No, I don't think that is true to say. I think what we've said, that we'll have to have a return on investment. So I don't know if there was a prospect of the airport being taken over. It would have to include a deal which allowed us to repay the taxpayer for the investment which they'd undertaken, and I'm not sure how that would happen because we don't have that in prospect. We've not got an offer to do that just now.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
John, I think that's a reasonable question which we need to develop more on to find out how the investment is actually worked out and what level of return that you would expect. So I think that may come later, but I mean, I think the Cabinet Secretary's point that he is constantly scrutinising the management team of Prestwick Airport fills neatly in, because it is our intention, Cabinet Secretary, is to ask them to come and speak to the committee in May, which I think would help inform the committee on this. If I could then leave that section there and move very briefly to the fourth replacement crossing, and Stuart has a question for you, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener. We've heard a bit about it, so perhaps this is just a fairly brief answer required. We're close to completing the project. Are we still on time and on budget?
Budget, again, I don't want to steal the thunder of David Climie, but we still are looking at around £245 million below the budget. And we've had discussions about the extent to which that's attributable to lower than expected inflation and also good project management. That has, to the extent there's been any change, and maybe David Climie can speak to that, there's been no deterioration in that, so we're not expecting that to change for the worst. Again, on timing, and again, David will be able to say more about this than I can, the latest from the contractor, and just as with Prestwick Airport, we're in pretty regular dialogue, is that they still hope to finish in May. It'll be towards the end of May, that was the intention, and still have confidence around certainly completing it before the contracted completion date, which I think was mid-June. I think it's also true to say, and again, David could speak at greater length on this than I, there have been higher than expected and more sustained levels of wind speed than they expected. There's no doubt about that. And the particular problem that's caused is in the removal of the cranes, which you see on the towers. So that probably wasn't on the critical path before, but it is now. One, I think, has been either completely taken down or partially taken down. The other two will be taken down concurrently to make up for lost time. And some of the other things which have to be done in terms of the windshield and the surface are not so susceptible to weather as we were coming up to the lifting of the last piece of deck, which was delayed somewhat. So there have been delays, as we've always said, by weather. No delays for any other reasons that I'm aware of. No deterioration in the budget position. I have made clear, both to Transport Scotland and to the contractor, I don't want this done at breakneck speed. If there's any question of health and safety being brought into question, that's what should be the priority. But the latest position we have from the contractor, and as I say, David, we'd be able to get more information as I expect to finish that in May, although it is challenging.
Thank you for that. When I was minister, they came and told me it would be 3.4 or 4.3 million. So we're doing a wee bit better than that. Looking to the opening, can you tell us about the plans for how the bridge will be opened, both formally and in practice?
Nothing much just yet, other than the fact that there is substantial discussion going on within Transport Scotland. Michelle is, I think, heavily involved in that, so she may be able to say more. We have had a huge number of expressions of interest from members of the public and organisations. There's a huge focus on this, but the plans are being considered just now, and I would assure Stuart Stevenson that if he thinks about the arrangements that went into the Borders Rail opening, which is a very substantial piece of work in its own right, we are undertaking that kind of diligence just now. But I don't know if Michelle wants to say more about that.
We have, thanks, Cabinet Secretary. We've had, as you can imagine, a number of suggestions and requests from the public about the sort of thing that they would like us to consider, the sort of people that they would like us to have involved, a number of requests from charities, you know, the whole plethora of options, actually. And we are well underway now with arriving at some sort of a conclusion, which we hope to be able to come forward with in the next wee while. But suffice to say, we'll be looking at something that can involve as many people as we possibly can, because we accept that it's a major iconic structure, it's a new Scottish landmark, and people want to be involved and they're very enthusiastic about it. And even to date, we've had something like 68,000 visitors to the site in one form or another. So we want to be able to try and be as inclusive about this opportunity as we can.
You will be aware, of course, of one suggestion I've passed on, which would involve an interest from the northeast of Scotland. I commend it to you without providing any particular details at this stage.
I'm actually very concerned, Stuart, that interest is suggesting that you should be at the opening, and I'm sure, Cabinet Secretary, that would not be the case. Can I just say that I noticed one word in there that caused me concern was the word hope, and I'm sure the committee will want to pick that up with the team when we question them next, because it wasn't a cast iron guarantee. I think you used the word hope twice. I think if the committee's happy, sorry, do you want to ask a quick question on that, Mike?
It's really more a question for you than David Climie, because he's more on the technical basis, but I'm concerned about the number of vehicles. First of all, I can put it this way: the number of vehicles estimated to use the two bridges in the first year compared to the current level. And I just wanted to ask: has any sort of political been any reconsideration from a political level, rather than a technical one, as to allow both bridges to use cars and HGVs? Has there been any reconsideration of that? Because I'm just a bit concerned about the congestion levels.
Okay. Can I say one of the things to do, just to go back to the previous point about the opening, is I think a lot of people want to be able to commemorate for the last time being in a car on the Forth Road Bridge as currently constituted. So a number of people have written on the very issue that you have asked about, but it was written to the Act that the Parliament agreed the basis for the public transport corridor of the existing bridge. What we have always looked at and continue to look at is whether, in certain circumstances, if there was a problem on the new bridge, how quickly and how efficiently you could bring into operation. Mm-hmm. We're not anticipating any problems. I hope there won't be any problems, but if there was something that arose, and bear in mind the additional wind protection, so you won't have the closures to high vehicles.
So it would need a new Act of Parliament, basically, if you wanted to do it on a
regular basis?
I think maybe that is a bit more technical. I'll let Michelle answer that. But the original Act was, and Stuart Stevenson will know this, was very clear about the nature of the basis of a public transport corridor. And it may well be, and I think it is the case, that you can satisfy that requirement, but you could still potentially use the existing bridge in certain circumstances. I think that's where some examination's taken place.
I think that's correct, and I don't have a lot more to add to what the Cabinet Secretary said.
Okay, thank you.
I think we'll leave the bridge because we've got a session on that next, and Richard wanted to ask a question on motorways further south.
Morning, Cabinet Secretary. Under your stewardship, there has been many excellent projects brought about in the last number of years. The A9 dualling, talking about the A96 dualling, the M8, M73 and M74 motorway improvements. If I could take them just short answers, short questions in regards to A9 dualling. I anticipate it'll take up to 8 years to finish this project. Could we have done it any quicker?
No, there was some discussion about that, whether the timescale that we gave was to take account of the fact that you have to get the resources to do that, the money to do that. But in actual fact, when you examine it, and given some of the processes I've talked about, public inquiries and design and consultations, no, I don't believe it could be done any quicker than that.
A96 dualling, again, I see that it's not anticipated to be finished by 2030, which is 13 years from now. Could we have done that any quicker?
I think that I'd let the officials answer that, but I think, I suppose, if you wanted to truncate that, although you wouldn't have the same space, because obviously there's a correlation between the work that goes on in the A9 and A96, they come together apart from anything else. So I think it would have been a bit too crowded to have done those two things at the same time, but perhaps Michelle would be able to answer that.
Yes, and thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Another major factor here is actually you know, the availability of the supply chain and being able to have sufficient market when you go to the market to construct these projects, that you're not flooding the market, so that you can achieve a sort of value for money construction cost on these. So it's important for the civil engineering industry in Scotland that we're able to provide a pipeline of projects where we can. And with the three big projects finishing shortly, the A9, the Queensferry Crossing, or sorry, the AWPR, the Queensferry Crossing, and the M8, M73, M74, it's timely now to be able to bring forward the A9 projects next, and again after that to bring forward the A96. So it works in a variety of ways, and actually what it does is it sustains that industry in Scotland.
It certainly has been a fantastic number, the last number of years, the amount of work that's going on and the number of jobs, construction jobs, and being on the some of the projects. And I've had the distinction of going under the M74 and the new opening of the underpass at the Wraith, and it's quite marvellous. But it was marvellous for a few days, and then it was flooded. Why?
There was a snagging issue, which was, you'll know the Wraith underpass better than me, it's completely or substantially under the water table. And one of the big projects, parts of the project, was to get the water pumps, which were there to, in order to allow the construction works to take place, and as you know, it's substantially below ground. And then essentially a large, it's not a pail, but structure, which then prevented the water coming in. So they did, as you rightly say, a few days afterwards have an issue with some water ingress, which they've stopped. And they're doing some further work on finding out the source of that. The actual structure itself remains under the water table. The pumps have gone now, but as I say, it's not continued, it's stopped, and they'll do further investigations. And you do get, if you remember back to the M74 project, each project's different, but that one was, a lot of it was on stilts, and you had some collapsing of some parts of the surface, which is not at all unusual. So you do get snags. The important thing, I think, is they've fixed it very quickly.
Basically, the point of anticipation of timescales of when work will be finished. When did we anticipate the M8, M74, M73 project would be finished, and what now is the anticipated time of getting all this all cleared away?
Well, the answer is the same for both. We said, I think, the spring of this year. and that's what we intend to do. And just to say that you've quite rightly mentioned the number of projects which have been undertaken. You could have mentioned the Hags to Steps project as well, the M74 itself. These have been done, as with the Borders Rail, on time. I was in Berlin yesterday. The airport there is 6 years overdue and hugely over budget. I think we've had a pretty remarkable record. Huge infrastructure projects are hard to bring in on time, especially when you go into rail, but we have had a pretty good track record in doing that.
I can see the end is in sight. I have to say that you've helped me and my constituents and the people of Scotland tremendously with these new projects. And I was especially also had the, a couple of days ago, went round the diversion, which was quite interesting. Yeah. But I could see the point of it. So is there anything else you think has to be done in regards to these projects in order to ensure that they're completed?
Well, you never take your foot off the accelerator with all these projects, and I think the M8 bundle, that's required a lot of work to make sure that we get this done on time, working with the contractor. It's true of all the contracts, and it's really pleasing to see that it's come on board in the way it has. It's provided a lot of employment, and I think, as I said in the last time I came to the committee, it's perhaps not had the attention that it deserves. It'll make a major transformation in central Scotland, but the Queen's Ferry Crossing's obviously kind of dominated that agenda.
And one last question.
Analogy of the Cabinet Secretary, because I've got two questions.
Yeah.
Could you check in your rear-view mirror just before you launch into a question, and could you make it short, please?
Yeah, Peter Chapman asked about complaints. Have you had many complaints from people that run alongside these projects, and how are we doing to resolve them?
We have, not least from yourself and others, and I think it's true to say that you cannot undertake these huge projects without sometimes having those concerns, especially around diversions, where people are used to travelling a particular route and they can't do it during the period of construction. We've tried to be as sympathetic as we possibly can be, and we'll continue to do that.
Thank you very much.
Cabinet Secretary, we've got two more questions, and I would like to try and get them both in. So if I could encourage the questioners to be short and short answers. Rhoda.
As short as I possibly can. Can I ask about any plans to dual the A9 North, because it's only been dualed as far as Inverness, and before that happens, progress on the Berriedale Braes, which the public inquiry has been concluded. When will that work start? When will it be complete?
On the first point, we don't have currently plans to upgrade. We always examine a trunk roads and see where we can improve them, but we don't have plans to dual that. And I think the road usage would be very hard to justify that level of investment. Certainly there should be improvement, but not to dual standard. On the second issue, I don't know, it's my colleague, the Hamza Youssef, that now takes over that particular project. It's not one of the major projects, very important locally. I was very pleased that we were able to bring it forward, also as Transport Minister. But I think if you can, either we can talk to Hamza and make sure there's an update provided in writing to the committee, just exactly where we're at, the public inquiry haven't been concluded, or Hamza can come to the committee.
On the 29th of March, so I'm sure we can make sure that question is part of the thing. I'd like to go to the final question, which is from Mari.
Thank you very much. You mentioned in your statement at the beginning there about the Lawrencekirk Junction, and obviously a couple of weeks ago we had an engagement event that was held in Lawrencekirk with Transport Scotland and AMI, and from what I understand from speaking to the people there, it was very well attended. I think Mike attended on the day as well, and the reception of that was quite well, and I think it went a long way to addressing a lot of the concerns that people have had and contacted me about in terms of, you know, why the project length and the different stages of the project too. So it's just really to see what the plans are for future engagement with the community in Lawrencekirk and obviously wider communities in the Angus and Aberdeenshire areas who are affected by the junction.
It will be for Hamza Youssef to take that forward. My involvement, and it really was because it was worked into the Aberdeen City Region deal, which I had been involved in. But I don't know if Michelle wants to say anything. I should just say, it is my view, being involved in these things now for a number of years, the more engagement you can have, and sometimes it's difficult, the better the final result will be. People are more accepting of it, but I don't know if you want to say more than that.
Over the next year or so, we hope to undertake more work on options assessment for the junction itself. And in doing that, we will continue our consultation with local residents and local communities. And that will allow us to start the statutory processes during that period. And as part of those statutory processes, built into those, if you like, there is a process for engaging with local communities and allowing us to be able to receive feedback, both formal and informal feedback, which helps us to adjust our designs and to make them more acceptable to those communities.
Sorry, John wants to ask a question, and Stuart, maybe just get one in very quickly at the end. Sorry, John, if I could ask you to be brief.
Convener, Cabinet Secretary, you wouldn't necessarily have this information at hand, but perhaps a few of your officials could provide it. With £6 billion projects with A986, both these roads roughly have a rail line that mirrors the general route. There's very modest expenditure on the upgrade of these both these lines. I wonder if a timeline has been prepared about the projections about modal shift, unfortunately, rail to road, and what the implications would be for the road and rail networks of that, if that could be provided, please.
Can I just... Because this sort of ties into another question with railways. John, could you... Stuart, could you just add your question to that, and maybe they could be answered together?
My question is quite a simple one. In planning for the Inverness to Nairn dualling, are you interfacing with the planned new railway station at Inverness Airport?
The short answer to the last question is yes, that's been taken into account. And on the John Finney's point, I will come back. It will be Hamza Youssef that will take, although it's a relationship obviously to the major projects which I'm involved in, but he, in relation to the city deal, the improvement works for the Inverness to Aberdeen line are meant to be complementary. I think it's around £270 million, but as I say, it's Hums that's taken it forward. And I'm more than happy to come back to the committee and to the member about the extent to which we're taking into account modal shift. There are two new stations, for example, proposed on that line at Kintore and Dalcross, I think it was. So that obviously is designed to try and encourage people to use the train in those locations rather than the road. So it has been taken into account, but I'll come back, or my colleague Hamza Youssef will come back in writing, if that's okay.
I'm under pressure for one more question, and I'm minded to let Mike very quickly.
It's more than Michelle, really. I mean, in Lawrence Kirk, for many years we've been on top of this. I know you have to go through a process of options, but there is only one practical option, because if you have the road from Fettercairn, the practical option is the Southern Junction. Everybody really knows that's the one. It's where all the junction activity the government have been involved with. So is there any way of speeding that process up?
I can assure Mr. Rumbles that we are going as quickly as we possibly can. But in order for us to complete the statutory processes in a robust way that ensures that we don't have to revisit them and add more time to the programme, we need to give proper consideration to each of the options.
Okay, and I'm definitely going to end this session here. So I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary. If there's anything you'd like to say before you leave, or are you happy that the points you wanted to put across have been made?
I am happy with that, and I will, if it's okay with yourself and the committee, convener, come back to you when we have substantial updates. We can't always be as open as we'd like to be about developments. Some of them are commercially confidential, but where we have, especially in the projects that you've previously expressed an interest in, we are not trying to keep anybody in the dark. Sometimes we're not able to say as much as we'd like, but we want to keep the committee as aware, and I see this as the preferred route for doing that. Of course, if there's something substantial, we would go to Parliament, but I will continue. So please, as with last time when I came and asked to speak to the committee, don't think there's some great revelation, but we will try and keep the committee as updated as we can, especially given where we're at with some very substantial projects coming to conclusion now.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you, Michelle and Graham, for attending the meeting. I'm going to suspend the meeting briefly to allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Thank you. Now move on to agenda item two on the committee's agenda today, which is the fourth replacement crossing. I welcome David Climie, the project director, and Lawrence Shackman, the project manager for the fourth replacement crossing team. And David, would you like to make an opening statement on how things are progressing?
Certainly, yes. We're very pleased to be here this morning to update the committee on progress made since our last appearance on the 14th of December. I can confirm that the project outturn cost range remains as £1.325 to £1.35 billion, and that we continue to be targeting May for opening to traffic. We expect to be making an announcement on the precise date and the opening events being planned in the next few weeks, following a further programme review of all finishing activities by FCBC, the contractor. While it has been a relatively mild and dry winter, we've still encountered regular windy conditions, which have continued to affect the stay cable installation, tower crane removal, and tower falsework removal in particular. However, the contractor, FCBC, has continued to make significant efforts to mitigate the effects of the wind by resequencing, reprogramming, and adding additional resources as and where possible. The site workforce has averaged 1,282 in the past 12 months and is currently running at nearly 1,350. Due to the changing nature of the works that we're doing now to completion, over 600 new workers have received a site induction since we returned to work in January. Focusing on progress on the principal contract, on the south side, the roadworks are substantially complete with final landscaping and planting works continuing. Work on the local roads around Queensferry has also been virtually completed in the period. On the Queensferry crossing itself, all the deck units have now been lifted into place, with the last one being lifted on the 3rd of February. And I'm sure that you will have noticed from the media coverage that day that the focus was very much on the site workforce. It showed very clearly that they are highly dedicated, motivated, and enthusiastic, and want all of Scotland, and indeed the world, to know about the success of the bridge and to celebrate it. The final 400mm gap between the south approach viaducts and the cable-stayed bridge was jacked closed on the 27th of February on the southbound side and the 1st of March on the northbound side. Final welding of these joints is currently in progress, and then the final four deck concrete pours will be carried out to complete the main bridge deck. This will allow the inside of the boxes to be made weathertight and allow the installation and commissioning of the deck dehumidification equipment, as well as the ongoing installation of electrical, mechanical, and plumbing systems throughout the structure. On the deck finishing activities, all the stay cables have been installed on the south and centre towers, and there are only two stay cables remaining to be lifted at the north tower. Work on installing the vehicle restraint barriers and the windshielding has progressed well, with 80% of the posts erected and 8% of the acrylic louvers positioned. Deck waterproofing commenced on the 5th of January in the central reservation and on the 27th of January on the main carriageway. And so far, 8% of the surface area has been completed to date. An initial delivery of deck asphalt was laid on the 15th of February, followed by 400 tonnes on the 17th of February, which was laid in about 4 hours and covered a 350-metre length of the southbound carriageway. This is being the first of two layers of binder course, which will be covered by the final surfacing immediately prior to opening. And three out of the four of the bridge expansion joints have been installed. Work started on removal of the first tower crane at the North Tower on the 21st of January and is now well progressed. But this has been a particularly frustrating area for FCBC, with no work possible due to wind between the 11th and 27th of February, as we needed a 48-hour window with winds below 25 miles an hour to remove the supports attached to the towers and remove the crane mast sections. The temporary trestles and platforms on either side of the North Tower were removed on the 29th and 30th of January and then the 23rd and 24th of February. Once the tower crane is removed, the remaining concrete section of deck where the crane's mast was located can be cast. These activities will be repeated at the centre and south towers over the next 2 months. On the north side roadworks, the mainline A90 was diverted over the new emergency crossover alignment just before Christmas for northbound traffic and on the 20th of January for southbound traffic. This released the area for construction of the new southbound slip roads from the new Ferry's Hole Junction to the Queensferry Crossing and for the public transport link to the Forth Road Bridge. Work on Hope Street and Inverkeithing and the reconfigured park and ride facility at Ferry Toll should be completed by the end of this month. Works on the Intelligent Transport Systems, the ITS, and the Bridge Control Room fit-out are continuing to be progressed. Regular handover meetings have been taking place with AMI, the Forth Bridges operating company, to prepare them for the operation and maintenance of the bridge and the approach roads after opening. Community relations continue to be extremely good, with the North and South Community Forums meeting as a single entity for the second time in February. And we've now had over 70,000 people attend an event relating to the Forth replacement crossing, with nearly all of these being held in the project's Contact and Education Centre. And of those, over 20,000 of them are school pupils who've attended from all across Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, David. A very comprehensive brief. Mike, would you like to ask the first question?
Thanks very much, Convener. And I'd like to focus on the money, if you like, the budget for the project. And on after your last appearance, you sent a letter to the Convener on the 23rd of January, which is very helpful. And you've confirmed again in your opening statement that the current budget is 1.35 billion, and you've confirmed that. In your letter, you said the reduction of 245 million in the project budget is due to two things. One, a reduction of 192 million pounds for lower than expected inflation. The remaining saving of 53 million pounds is a reduction in the allowance for risk and optimism bias. So that brings it down to the figure you've confirmed of 1.35 billion. So you actually say in your letter that at that fixed budget, at that budget of 1.35 billion, it includes an estimate, a new estimate for inflation of just 45 million pounds. And I was really wondering, now that inflation is rising again, is that 45 million pounds sufficient in the budget? And is the 1.35 billion pounds now fixed? Is that a result now because it is a fixed price contract?
Okay, the two questions you've asked. Firstly, inflation is starting to rise, and you're quite correct. We're seeing that in the construction indices now. Mm-hmm. Over the past 4 years, what we've traditionally seen is you initially get a provisional index, and then it's made a final index about 3 months later. Mm-hmm. And in the past 4 years, we'd seen a blip in the summer when the provisional indices had kicked up, and then subsequently, when they'd been made final, they'd drop back again. We haven't seen that this time, in that the indices are continuing to rise, and for the first time there's actually an upward curve on it now. The benefit that we have, though, is that because of the extent of the project, we're over 95% complete, there's very little of the remaining money to be paid that's actually exposed to inflation. So therefore, the £45 million that we're talking about, we're very confident that that will not change and can be achieved. The second point you asked, could you just remind me what it was?
Yeah, is therefore the budget of £1.35 billion, that's because it wouldn't have increased because it's basically a fixed-term contract.
That's correct, yes. Yeah. We still firmly believe that the 1.35 is a ceiling.
Yeah, so that's the ceiling, and basically the reduction is down to basically inflation and, as you say here, a reduced allowance for risk and optimism bias.
Correct.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Okay. John, you got the next question.
Thank you, Convener. I mean, you did, Mr. Clooney, mentioned the weather had been a bit of an effect, and that was, 16 days that you couldn't work because of the wind on the cranes. Has that been the only major problem? I mean, I don't think the frost and the snow has been too severe.
That's true. I think you would characterise the winter as being reasonably favourable. I would say, if you look out the window today, it's a beautiful sunny day. At the moment, it's blowing 40 miles an hour on the bridge deck out at the bridge, which means that there are a number of operations that cannot go on. And it has been quite typical of the winter, in that it's been bright, it's been sunny, but the wind has been quite an issue over the period. We've focused on the areas it does affect, which are the tower crane removal and also the stay cable installation. And it's the stay cable installation at the top, at the tower end, that is the issue. Down at the deck level, which you've seen for yourselves, the work there can continue, even with the wind blowing quite significantly. And obviously, the more wind shielding that we're able to install, the more benefit that actually gives the workers on the deck for carrying out those activities. So the work on the deck is progressively becoming less wind sensitive, but it doesn't take away the issue with the trestles underneath the deck, allowing to lower those onto barges, and also to remove the tower crane. Particularly on the tower crane, I'd just like to expand on that a little bit more, if I might. We started dismantling the North Tower crane on the 21st of January. And the key issue with the tower cranes is that, as you'll see up till now, the main jib of the tower crane is above the level of the tower. Now, that means when the wind blows, the crane actually acts like a weather vane. So once the wind gets above 40 miles an hour and the crane can't operate, the crane jib actually points the way the wind is blowing. And what that does is it minimises the load on the mast. Once we start to lower the crane down, obviously at that point the crane jib is blocked by the tower from being able to rotate. So we actually have to lock the crane mast in its set position, which runs parallel to the bridge deck. Now what that means is that if you get significant winds, that puts much more load on this crane mast than would normally happen. So therefore there was a constraint when we were starting to lower the tower crane, which was once we were beyond the top of the tower, before we could take the next tie section to the tower out and the next mast sections down, we needed a 48-hour window with no winds above 25 miles an hour. Now we were ready to start that operation on the 11th of February, and we just didn't get that 48-hour window until the 27th of February. When we did get it, which is 9 days ago now, we've progressed very quickly. We've got three of the ties out. All of the jib is now removed from the crane and work can progress. But obviously there's the potential that we could get a similar issue arising with the centre and the south tower cranes. That could happen. We're not saying it will, but it could. But what FCBC has done to mitigate that is that originally they were going to do the cranes sequentially. So they would do the north and the south and the centre. They're now mobilising to be able to work on the south and the centre simultaneously so that if there is the suitable weather comes along, we can make the most of it. So that, again, mitigation is in effect for those items.
And I mean, for somebody who doesn't know very much like myself, a layperson, presumably the cranes do have to be completely out of the way before you can open the bridge.
Indeed they do, yes. Yes,
because you said that it gets filled in with concrete.
That's right.
Right, so is that the biggest risk weather-wise, that there continues to be wind and that restricts the removal of the cranes? I mean, I don't know if there's issues around if it's very wet. Does that cause a problem with the road surfacing?
Wet is also an issue, yes, and more with the waterproofing that goes on the deck rather than the road surfacing itself. Because the key to road surfacing is that all the various layers have to stick together well. You don't want the thing to start splitting apart and creating potholes. Now, the issue with the waterproofing is you must have a dry surface to put the waterproofing down. It's a spray-applied rubber membrane. So what you must guarantee is that you have a dry surface before you put that rubber membrane down. So therefore, you must have dry conditions for that. And if you don't have a dry surface, what happens is when you apply the asphalt on top of the waterproofing, you're applying the asphalt, it's very hot, and what it does is if there's any moisture trapped underneath the waterproofing, it vaporizes that moisture, that creates a bubble in the waterproofing, and actually pushes up and cracks the asphalt you've immediately placed. So what it means that we can check immediately after we put the first layer of asphalt down to make sure there is no issue like that. So there's a check within the overall process to make sure it has been dry when it's been put down, but it's very important that it is dry.
So these are biggest two risks, would you say, going for the next 2 or 3 months, that would be the wind and if it was very wet?
Correct, yes. And the two rate determining factors are that the waterproofing goes significantly slower than the laying of the asphalt does. So once we've got an area of asphalt to go at, as I mentioned in my opening statement, we've laid 350 metres of a single carriageway in about 4 hours. So the asphalt can be placed much more quicker than the waterproofing can be applied. Mm-hmm. So the two rate determining factors are getting the tower cranes down so we can close the holes in the deck, and which is wind related, and then applying the waterproofing, which is water related.
So you're 99% sure that we're on target for time? 98?
You
wouldn't like to put a figure on that?
Gather your thoughts. The Cabinet Secretary, when he was here and talking about it, said the word hope 3 times. I think we felt that that was fine at that stage. We're quite keen to tie you down to a period. Is it going to be ready before the end of May?
That continues to be our target, and I expect it to be achieved. Now, I cannot give you a guarantee. There are no guarantees. And just let me, as an example, give you... Here's the long-range weather forecast, which I received in the Met Office first thing this morning. For the period from Sunday the 12th of March to Tuesday the 21st of March. Remaining unsettled for much of the UK, it will be rather windy with showers or longer spells of rain. However, conditions are likely to become drier, brighter and less windy as we head into the new working week, particularly across southern and eastern areas. During this time, we will probably still see occasional bands of rain moving in from the west to affect mainly the north of the UK. Later in the period, it may well gradually become more unsettled and windy again across the country, with gales in the northwest at times. Temperatures will probably be slightly above average, but still with the risk of night frosts, especially in central and southern parts. That's the next 2 weeks.
For the David, I have to say, I think you've certainly done a first. I don't think ever that a committee's had the weather forecast read to it. But and maybe that is a distraction method. Can I just try and pin you down one more time? is your hope more than hope? Is it a realistic option if things go well?
No, absolutely yes. It is, okay. It is still a realistic possibility to get traffic on the bridge in May. If it wasn't, I would tell you.
Okay, thank you.
However, I will not guarantee it for the reasons I've just outlined.
Okay. I think Gail is going to ask you a question on more mundane things than the weather, maybe.
Oh, no, I wouldn't say that. Good morning. Thank you for coming in. I think it's worth mentioning in the front page of your update, along with the fantastic picture of the last segment getting lifted into place, that we now have the tallest bridge in the UK and the longest three-towered cable-stayed bridge in the world. That's quite something. And I don't think, don't take this the wrong way, but I don't think I've ever been as excited about a bridge as I am about this one, and it is absolutely beautiful. You mentioned landscaping in your opening statement, and I know that we did speak about this when we were visiting at the end of October. You also say in the update that last year you put in 40,000 trees and shrubs, this year a further 50,000, but the target is 400,000 trees and shrubs. Mm-hmm. Could you tell us a little bit more about where they come from, where they were sourced, what they are, trees, what type they are, and also considering that you have quite a bit more planting to do, is there a time scale for the planting? Because obviously that's going to continue once the bridge is open.
Yes, I can. Let me start, I think. In terms of the landscaping and in terms of the supply of the trees and plants and so on, what we wanted to ensure was that we had Scottish provenance for all the plants and trees that were going to be supplied. So what we did is we did not leave that up to the contractor. We basically placed a direct order with a company, that's actually an English-based company, but all the provenance of the materials is from Scotland. And basically it's a call-off contract. So we told them in outline what it is we want, and the contractor then calls them off in terms of what they want them, and they're paid for what they plant. So there's a rate for planting trees, for planting shrubs, for planting grasses and so on. And that guarantees that we get the right provenance of what we're planting. In terms of the programme, we have a planting season, effectively, that generally runs from October through to March. And because that's obviously the time when you're not putting things in dry ground. Inevitably, that means that not everything will be done by March of this year, and therefore we'll go into the next planting season, October through to the end of the year, in terms of finishing off the planting. So there will still be some to be done at that point, but a relatively small amount, and just in the areas where the final road changes have been made on the north side, so a very limited area in terms of that. Anything to add, Lawrence?
No, I'll just say that the contractor FCBC is responsible for maintaining all that planting through the five-year defect notification period, and in fact on the other two earlier contracts that were completed 4 years ago, all the plants and shrubs that were planted in those contracts have been maintained through all of that period, making sure if there are any failures at all that they're replaced and they're sourced through the contract that we competitively tendered some years ago now.
Thank you. No, that's fine. Thanks.
Okay. The next question is Richard.
Gentlemen, can you tell me if there has been any new issues of concern raised by local residents or businesses during the last couple of months, and if there has, how have we resolved these?
Yeah, sure. I think community engagement, we're very much still ongoing with engagement with the communities, both on an individual level and with the community forums. In terms of the forums, we last met on the 28th of February, and that's the means of the local community groups and previous objectors to the scheme, in fact, coming together and representing the views of their colleagues and the residents of Queensferry, Inverkeith, Ingresyth, etc. So they're now focusing more on what will happen post-opening. Touched on the road users or the bridge users guide at the last meeting. They're keen to understand that. We've shared that with them. So they know how the road network is going to work to some extent, but they're keen to know how it's going to be maintained, who will be responsible for it. So we're in the process of setting up meetings to let them know once we open the bridge, the role of the operating company, AMI, the local authorities for the local roads, and of course FCBC will have obligations under the contract for a period, as I touched on, for the landscaping, for example. So those are the main sort of issues. They're also keen to understand the remaining activities and when they'll be completed, and some of the other obligations that were placed in the Fourth Crossing Act, such as the footpath cycleway that's being constructed from the A904 down to the south abutment of the bridge and back up the other side to form a bypass of the Queensbury Junction. So trying to give them an indication of when that work will be finished. Some additional works to improve footpaths on Society Road, which we said that we would undertake as the clear-up process from the south side of the Forth progressed southwards as the contractor's tidying up his site, and that work will be undertaken during 2017. So that's a brief flavour of the sorts of issues that we're discussing with the local communities.
You actually have anticipated my next question, right, and basically answered it. Can I say, as a child, I was fortunate to go along and see the new Forth Road Bridge and find me. What sort of things will we ensure that we're going to continue to work with AMI, work with local communities to ensure that people can again commemorate one of the most iconic buildings? I think the three bridges together is absolutely fantastic.
Well, one of the key things is that the contact and education centre, and I think we also touched on that at the last time we were in front of this committee, and we're fully intending to keep that going way into 2018 and engage with the schools as we have been. David mentioned that we've now had over 20,000 pupils actually attend events in the contact centre since January 2013. So we fully intend to keep that going, and we will put a case forward to try and make sure that the facility or a similar facility is kept going well into the future. So there's a little bit of work to do to flesh that out. I think you're right, it's an iconic bridge, and the whole situation is really a world first, having three bridges from three different centuries in the same location. And there's work from Visit Scotland and Event Scotland. We're talking to them quite considerably in terms of the marketing of the area going forward for not only the local economy, but also to market Scotland as a whole. So there's a lot of potential there, the education legacy side of things. Could go on.
Thank you for the work you've done, gentlemen. Thank you.
Okay, the next question is on public transport and comes from John Finney.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. And thank you for your update. And we've had an update on public transport, and I know that there's been engagement with the bus operators and some training already undertaken. Are you able to indicate what the likely changes to bus service operations are going to be as regards the crossing, please?
Surely. The bus operators, they all came in for a training day on the 28th of February, and we took them through a comprehensive run-through of all the bus facilities, bus hard shoulder running facilities, a look back on what we'd built as part of the two original contracts, and all the new facilities being built around the ferry toll park and ride, the fact that they'll be able to use the hard shoulders on the Queensbury crossing when buses are wind affected on the existing bridge, for example. So we gave them a comprehensive run through, and they seem to be really pretty impressed with what facilities they're going to be given. Obviously, going into the future, we would hope that the bus operators will have more services. We're looking towards having an education programme to try and ensure that the public are informed as much as possible about the potential for using bus as opposed to using car, obviously in terms of getting to Edinburgh in the main. So there's a programme that we need to set up, or we will be setting up in the future, I should say, to try and encourage people out of their cars and use the buses, and that, of course, would help to stimulate bus use in the future.
Thank you. And we're aware of the strategy and the fact that there is a public transport group, and previous occasions when you've been here, I've asked about the wider implications of that, and I understand there was engagements with the local authorities, the Lothians councils, for instance. Is that ongoing? Because I quite appreciate your obligation as to that crossing, but clearly if you funnel people quickly into an area, there are potentially significant implications for the wider road network.
Yeah, the Public Transport Working Group met in the middle of December, was the last meeting, and we've got another meeting planned for April. And a large proportion of that group actually came to the bus training day, so all the local relevant local authorities actually attended that event. In terms of working with them going forward, we see that Public Transport Working Group extending into the future a fair bit after the crossings open, because we're keen to see how all of the bus facilities work, to see whether we can... Well, they're meeting all the requirements in terms of the reliability of bus journeys, and obviously hoping to stimulate further growth in the bus sector. Aside from that, we will do monitoring in the future on the project as a whole in terms of journey time reliability. We'll try and capture patronage, that kind of thing, in our before and after reporting, which we will do at intervals post-opening, 1 year, 3 years, perhaps 5 years after opening. So we will get some feedback as to how the measures have been implemented, how successful they've been, and how hopefully they've stimulated further journeys.
Thank you. Finally, if I may, just a very small point. Can you comment on foot traffic and cyclists and how they all fit in the new arrangements, please?
Yes, they're obviously featured to some extent in the user's guide, which I've mentioned previously, but we will certainly be wanting to encourage people to continue to use the Forth Road Bridge for cycling and walking. And of course, we've mentioned before, freed from all the motorway traffic, if you like, which will be all on the Queensbury crossing, the Forth Road Bridge should be a much nicer environment for doing those activities. So hopefully it'll be self-perpetuating, because it will be such a much more pleasant surrounding. We also have a lot more cycleway and footpath facilities built in at either end of the bridge in terms of the connecting roads, links into the ferry toll park and ride, into North Queensbury on the north side, South Queensbury on the south. So wherever possible, we've tried to improve on the cycle and footpath facilities.
Okay, many thanks indeed. Thank you.
Thanks, John. I think, Jamie, you wanted to ask about the user's guide a bit, did you?
Yeah, I just wanted to move things forward a little bit from sort of the information around the build progress and update, and they've been very helpful and very useful, thank you. But as we move into more of the looking beyond the opening, we have a few questions around some of the what-if scenarios. I think the main one really is, given that we don't have a definitive opening date, I guess I have a question which is around the sort of notice period that users will need around the opening. So at which point will you take a view on this? So, and I'm not asking whether or not you'll hit the deadline, that's a different discussion, but from a practical point of view, at which point will you actually say, right, in 4 weeks' time, we are confident that we will be able to open so that users are aware of it?
I think we're getting really close to that point, to be quite honest. I would expect within the next 3 or 4 weeks, we'll be very close to that point. But when you say people need to know, it's going to be fairly self-explanatory, because what's happened is, because we've built the emergency crossovers at either end of the bridge, it's not quite like changing a set of points on a railway line, but in terms of the main A90, we literally will overnight change the barriers, and that will divert traffic onto the new alignment, so that all the motorway traffic will be diverted from the Forth Road Bridge onto the Queensbury crossing. Right. So for 99.5% of the traffic, it will just be literally the barriers will be moved to either end of the bridge and they'll be going onto the Queensbury crossing. For the public transport, the people like the buses, the taxis and so on, who will be able to use the Forth Road Bridge, that's really where the road users guide is specifically directed to give them some more help on that. And what we intended to do is in the 4 weeks before the final date, we will be doing some extensive publicity in terms of what's going to be happening in terms of the traffic management, when the changeovers are going to take place and what they're going to look like. Because we've done that very successfully throughout the works in the ferry toll area. So we intend to do exactly the same thing again for the main opening.
Okay, so just from your answer there, it sounds like from a road traffic car point of view, it should be quite self-explanatory. Once a change takes place, drivers should be able to follow relevant signage. I presume all that would have been used, tested, so and so on beforehand. But from all other users' point of view, there, you did mention in the last visit to the committee that you would produce a guide. Any updates on when that will be produced, what sort of content will be in it, who it's going to, how it will be distributed, what type of users it's going to be distributed to, just so that we've got comfort, I guess, that all other users other than cars will be comfortable with the new method of travel.
Yeah, well, the road users guide itself, we did actually send a draft of it to you after our last appearance. We've had some feedback from various people since then. The final version of it has now been produced, and the intention is that, say, within the four-week period before we actually do this, that we'll be distributing it very, very widely and making it available on our website as well. So it'll be I think we're looking at a print run of probably around 10,000, okay, as well as actually distributing it through all the various associations, local authorities, bus companies and so on that we deal with, taxi firms as well. So there's a good plan there for making sure we get this information distributed out, and it is a very, very comprehensive guide. So really, no matter what type of vehicle, pedestrian, cyclist, motorcyclist you are, you'll be able to very clearly identify where to go.
So there's about 10,000 being printed and distributed, not to everyday households, but to specific user groups, is that right?
That's right, yeah. I think in the immediate area, we'll probably distribute them to individual households as well, because they're the people who will be perhaps most affected with the local roads, so we'll make that very clear.
And just on quickly on your public awareness campaign, does that include some above-the-line media spend on letting people know about the change, or
yes,
do you have just some budget aside for that?
That's very much built into our overall comms budget. It's a fundamental part of the strategy of comms to make sure that it's well publicised. As I say, we've got a good template for it in what we've done at Ferry Toll with all the information there, so we intend to build on that and expand on that for it.
Great, thank you.
We'll also have drop-in sessions for the public. They can call into the Contact and Education Centre if they need any further information, and certainly having some public meetings as well, so that if anyone has got particular queries, we can answer those for them.
Thank you.
Okay. Peter, have you got a small question?
Just a small one on that. I think you've made it fairly clear that it should be pretty obvious to folk. But, you know, when new roads open, there are obviously often bits of confusion. If somebody does get it wrong and they land up on the wrong bridge for whatever reason, how are you going to enforce that? And are there going to be any penalties for folk that do get it wrong in the first few weeks?
I think there will need to be a transition period, inevitably. Yeah. People can make mistakes, clearly, when things are new. But on the slip roads to the fourth road bridge, there will be very clear signage as to what's allowed and what's not allowed. This will be monitored also by automatic number plate recognition systems, Big Brother to a degree. But obviously also the fourth road bridge does have an existing CCTV camera system, so that's monitored regularly as well to make sure of that. Now, what we also intend to do is, in the initial stages, we'll probably have an enhanced police presence, just again to direct people as much as anything, not to try to be overzealous at the start, because we anticipate things will happen. And perhaps similarly on the Queensferry crossing, one thing we're considering is that it's going to be a motorway, so the normal speed limit will be 70 miles an hour. We're considering at the moment the possibility of, when we do initially open it, run it at 50 miles an hour, because people driving over for the first time, there's always that tendency to want to look around at what's going on instead of focusing on where they should be going. Yeah. So we've been talking with the police about this, and it may well be that for an initial period, again, just till people get used to using it, we might put a 50-mile-an-hour speed limit on it, because that would just seem sensible in terms of people getting used to it.
That's fine. Thank you.
That doesn't give you the right to do a last nostalgic trip over the bridge and ignore the AMPR. Sorry, Richard, you've got a small question.
Yeah, small, quickly. People who don't know the area, what about sat-nav updating, you know, to say that this bridge is now open? Because your sat-nav takes you anywhere it wants to go.
No, that's absolutely true, and I'll make sure that within our communication strategy, we are in contact with the sat-nav companies to make sure that's dealt with.
Thank you.
You had a question.
Just a supplementary to that about traffic diversions. At times of high wind, the new bridge is able to cope with that, the old bridge not so. Given that the old bridge is dealing with kind of public transport and the like, is there the ability to easily divert that onto the new bridge? And will there be any priority given? Because obviously the diversion is going to create a delay.
Go on.
Right. Do the same thing. Yes, very much a lot of thought went into how we would try and safeguard public transport and try to keep the journey times as reliable as possible when there were high winds. So single deckers and double deckers, I think, are affected by the high wind strategy on the Forth Road Bridge when the wind speed gets up to 50 miles an hour. So in those situations, we've got signage, variable message signing, which will indicate to buses that they should use the Queensferry crossing. And in normal traffic conditions, they would just use the normal running lanes on the Queensferry crossing. Should the Queensferry crossing become congested and the speed limits or the variable speed limits are reduced down, then buses can use the hard shoulders on the Queensferry crossing, and they'll be directed to do that so that they can bypass the slower moving traffic, just as they do on the Fife ITS bus lane that we have in place at the moment. So therefore preserving as much as possible the vehicle routing for buses and the journey time reliability. So they'll be directed from the ferry toll junction, if you're coming southwards, up to use the Queensferry crossing, to then go into the hard shoulders. They run along the hard shoulders and then back off at the other end to their desired destination, so minimising the disruption.
Will similar be available to, for instance, if there was an accident on the new crossing, to divert traffic from the new crossing to the old bridge? And if there was kind of a wide load or something that was likely to slow traffic, could that be diverted as well?
If there was to be an incident on the Queensferry crossing, you've got to remember that we've got hard shoulders on the Queensferry crossing. So we've got a much better facility for providing resilience should a vehicle break down or there be an incident. So there's a lot more room for vehicles to actually get past in the first place, whereas obviously on the Forth Road Bridge, there's no hard shoulders, and any incident culminates in a tailback really pretty quickly. So we also have all the variable message signing. We have the lane control facilities to close lane with a red cross, which you've probably seen on the motorway network elsewhere in Scotland and the UK. We can control speed limits. And if there was an incident that was of a long duration, I can't really say definitively what a long duration is, but of a reasonable duration, it is possible, as David mentioned before, to actually reopen the emergency crossovers so that traffic could use the Forth Road Bridge.
There's three more questions Jamie wants to ask.
So. Based on what you just said, I probably should know the answer to this, but is there central reservation on the bridge? Or you talked about variable lanes. Does that include the flow of traffic? Could you, for example, have a 4-2 or a 3-3 or a 2-2? Or what are the sort of variation parameters that you have on that?
The Queensferry crossing has got a central reserve, and actually all the stay cables are in the central reserve, so there's no means of crossing over the carriageways. So the bridge itself has two lanes in each direction with hard shoulders, and as I say, they've got lane control units over each lane at regular intervals and variable message signing at regular intervals all the way through the project corridor to try and control the traffic. But no, we can't do 3+ or 4+2 or... Yeah, tidal flow conditions. We can't do that, I'm afraid.
Mr. Committee, any other questions? I think Mike's got a question, and then I've got a question at the end, if I may.
Thanks, Convener. It's just coming back to money, because this morning has been the end date of the end of May has been heavily caveated, both by yourself and the Minister earlier on. So my question really is, what happens if the bridge isn't completed by the contractual date in June, because it's the contractual date in June that we're up against? So are there any more costs to the public purse if that happens, or do the contractors pick up the bill on a fixed price contract?
Okay, well, on your first point, you say it's heavily caveated. I took up this post nearly 7 years ago, in April 2010. If someone had said to me that 7 years later I'd be sat in front of a committee discussing a 2 or 3 week variation in the opening date of the project and where the overall budget is in comparison to where it was when I joined the project, when it was £1.7 to £2.3 billion, I would have bitten their hand off. So you say we're caveating it. We're now on a seven-year project talking about a very small window of time.
Can I just ask, Are you therefore saying to us, and I'd be relieved if you are, that in fact, in your opinion, you're 100% certain that it won't go beyond the contractual date in June?
I think it's quite difficult to ask somebody to be 100% certain. Well, I mean, I think that the question you've asked, which David maybe could just answer, is just if there is unforeseen circumstances, whether there is an implication to the budget spend. Because I actually think it's unfair to ask him to be 100%, because you can never be 100% on most things in life.
Thank you, but well, in terms...
Except that he did say 2 or 3 weeks, and that would mean that he would be certain that it's not...
No. I'd rather David ask the question on the money, if I may.
Thank you. Now, in terms of the money, if there's an overrun on the contract completion date, there is no risk to the public purse in terms of that being an extra cost. Anything that runs past the contract date would be entirely down to the contractor. So there is no risk at all to the budget of going past the contract completion date. That's categorically 100%.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you for that 100% guarantee. David, I just want to ask a question to you. Is the first year is going to be absolutely critical once the bridge is open? And I'd just like some reassurance from you in the process of handing it over to the operator and the maintenance of it. And I'd like some assurances on what work is ongoing, and there will be periods of hand-holding to make sure that everything works and people understand. And perhaps you could just explain a bit of that to me, please, David.
Certainly. Obviously, you're aware that there's a Forth Bridges operating contract.
Yep.
Currently, Amy are the holders of that contract, and that's led by Mark Arndt. He's the lead for Amy on that. I think he's appeared in front of this committee a number of occasions. We've had a very close relationship with the Forth Bridges Operating Company, and previously FETA, even before that, because this goes back right to the very design stage of the bridge. We involved them in terms of maintenance, what they wanted built into it. So this has been an ongoing process very much since day one. And now, since Amy have come into position about 2 years ago, we've worked with them very closely. They come in, their technicians and their operators come and work and look at what we're building as we build it, so they can see exactly how it's being put together. They've come out within the last couple of weeks, and they've been inside the bridge deck to see all the various structural health monitoring and the mechanical and electrical equipment as that's being installed. And as part of FCBC's contract, they have an obligation to undertake training of all the AMI operatives to make sure they're fully familiar with everything, how it links into the bridge control room, how the structural health monitoring system works. And it's not a case of the bridge opens to traffic and we just hand over the keys and walk away, and neither does FCBC, the contractor. There's an ongoing obligation, and in fact a need, that we anticipate in the first 6 months after the bridge opens, there'll be a significant amount of tweaking and adjustment and so on of various things and items on the bridge itself. If the structural health monitoring is showing up some odd readings, to get all that checked out, verified. If a sensor isn't working, it might have to be replaced, that sort of thing. So there's a whole period of effectively handover. It's not a one day, it's about a 6 month period. We've worked that through in a great deal of detail. In terms of the governance of that, we actually had Mark Arndt come along to our project board last week to give them an update on how he felt things were. We'd been telling him from the project side of things how it was going, and we asked him to come along and give their side of the story as well. And I think he gave a very similar picture to what I've just given you, that there's very, very good engagement there, working very closely together. That will only increase over the next few weeks and will continue beyond the opening to traffic.
Okay, thank you. If there's no other questions, David, is there anything further that you think you'd like to bring to our attention, or do you believe that we've covered the majority of it already?
I think we've covered the majority of it, yes, thank you.
Okay, David and Lawrence, can I thank you for coming, and can I say that I hope we don't see you before May, because if we do see you, there will be a problem. But I think I can guarantee 100% that we'd like to see you later in the year to pick up on the project and to see where there are items that could be of relevance to future projects for Scotland. But I'd like to thank you and your team and hope that May is when we get to drive over the bridge. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I'd like to briefly suspend... I'd like to conclude that part of today's meeting in public session and suspend the meeting to allow the committee to move into private session. Thank you.